Welcome back, guys, and in this video we'll look at the back-end mathematics and the mathematical intuition of unit root and the augmented Dickey Fuller test. We have already seen augmented Dickey Fuller test and how to use it in time series, and that part was without the mathematical intuition. So if you are more interested in knowing how to use augmented Dickey Fuller test and KPSS test to find the stationarity of a time series and implement the API in Python, and you do not wish to see the mathematical intuition, then skip this video and go to the video on the top, which will show you how it is implemented. This video is for the mathematical part and derivation of it. Now, the most basic equation which we can learn from our experience of time series is that, imagine we are trying to predict a demand DT, and DT can be written in its most simplest form as alpha. Alpha is the level which we have in the time series. Beta is a coefficient, dt minus 1 plus some white noise. Why dt minus 1? Because dt minus 1 is the lag of the independent variable. And we have seen in this playlist that the lag of the independent variable, like in autoregressive model, can be used as a forecasting model. So this one is the lag. This is the lag of independent variable. In case we are, since we are trying to predict demand, I have written D. You can write it S also if we are trying to predict sell. Whatever might it is, just a variable. And beta is the coefficient which is there, and this is just the white noise, okay, randomness which we cannot predict. Now let's look carefully in beta, because this beta value is important. So I'll just erase this, because this is the same equation which is written, the same equation which I have just written down is written on top, and it is given as equation number 1. Now focus on this part. This part, if beta is greater than 1, where in this equation, if beta is greater than 1, the equation explodes, okay, because every forecast you make is going to be higher than the previous value. So it is going to explode like this. So there is no point of coming back to base or stationarity of the data. And if this is the case, this explode. Let me give you an example. So imagine you are doing DT in this case. Maybe my mean is 1 plus my beta is 3. So I take beta as 3 in the first plus, and D where T minus 1, and plus my noise is say 0. I ignore white noise. So D T plus 1 in the next, this value will give me 1 plus 3 D T minus 1. Correct. Again, if you put in the next plus, again you will have 1 plus 3 into 1 plus 3 d t minus 1. Correct. If you keep on doing it, the value explodes, right? You can again substitute some d t minus 1, but I think you have got the intuition, because every forecast that you are now making will be greater than the previous lag of the independent variable, because b is greater than 1 and this coefficient will keep on multiplying. Okay, now if b is less than 1, the opposite happens. If b is less than 1, your values will come towards 0. It will die out eventually. The equation will die out eventually, right? And so this in this case, your time series would be stationary. Let's try to do it when beta is less than 1. Say beta is equal to 0.5. My DT say is 100. So 100 is equal to 1 plus beta 0.5. So DT minus 1 is 100 plus 0. Noise is 0. Okay, so how much is it coming? 51, correct? 0.5 into 100 is 50. 50 plus 1 is 51. For the next period, which is DT plus 1, I'll again have 1 plus 0.5 into 51, right? So this will be how much is 25.5 plus 1 is equal to 26.5, correct? So the values are keep on decreasing. See, 51, 26.5. Probably it will come somewhere around 13, then 6.5, then 3, then 1.5, then less than 1, and eventually it comes home. Okay, so this one will die out. when beta is less than 1, and hence that part is stationary. But when you have beta is equal to 1, it shows the presence of a unit root, and it is a case of persistent impact. The impact of this coefficient, the impact of this beta coefficient has a persistent impact on the demand forecasting, and hence it's the presence of unit root. Now let's take the same example. We take beta is equal to 1, we take white noise is equal to 0, and alpha is equal to 1. So, and d t minus 1 as 100. Okay, so d of t will be 1 plus 1, because beta is 1, into 100 plus 0. So this gives me 101. D t plus 1 will be 1 plus 1 into 101, 102. D t plus 2, 1 plus 1 into, now this value will come 102. See, your values are constantly increasing, 1, 2, 3, okay. So this is a case of non-stationarity, and their impact is persistent, okay. So the impact would be persistent, and hence this is a case of non-stationary. So I repeat, if your beta is greater than 1, it will exponentially move out and it will explode. So this is definitely not fit. So if this is the case, you just ignore it. You cannot do any forecasting on this. You have to see, you probably have to go back to business and explain the situation. Try to see your use case, get some phrase data, or see if you can forecast from some other data set. So you have to change the business case altogether if your beta is coming greater than 1. So you can do nothing on it. Whereas in this case, if beta is less than 1, it is dying out and stationary. So you can go and directly try to implement your autoregressive models, for example. And if beta is equal to 1, there it is non-stationary, there is a presence, there is a persistent impact, and your time series is non-stationary. Then you have to do something to make it stationary. Like you can do differencing, you can do Box-Cox transformation to try to make it stationary. Then again apply your ADF and KPSS test and keep on doing it till the time you make it stationary. Okay, so that's the first part of the equation, and how important the value of the beta parameter is for this simple equation. Now, the fundamental tenet we have in time series forecasting is that we use the previous lag of the independent variable to forecast the future, right? So if we subtract dt minus 1 from both sides in equation 1, so this is equation 1 which I am talking so far, and subtract dt minus 1 from both sides. From both sides of the equation, I am subtracting dt minus 1, and then I rearrange the same in the next equation, which means I take the alpha and the white noise towards the end, the randomness at the end, and then I can keep dt minus 1 outside the bracket and take beta minus 1. It is just rearranging the equation. If you look carefully this part, I am just rearranging the equation. Okay, so I get dt minus 1 into beta minus 1. Plus the level and the randomness, right? Now I can always argue and put another value called as gamma, which is equal to beta minus 1. Now in this case also, if beta is equal to 1, your gamma will be 0. Why? Because gamma is equal to beta minus 1. 1 minus 1 is 0. If you have the case where gamma is equal to 0, this is also a case of non-stationarity. Try to implement this value, beta value here. If beta is 1 here, this part, entire part will become 0. You are just left with some constant value and your randomness, right? So it will be a case of non-stationarity, because you will just have the level and the trend present in the data, right? Because you just have those constant present in the data. Whereas if your beta value less than 1, if your beta value is less than 1, your gamma would be less than 0. So this part would be again less than 0. So if there is a diode impact, and your time series will be stationary. Okay, so that's the logic we can derive from taking gamma is equal to beta minus 1. Now let's see forward. Okay, now we have understood the first part, how unit root is. Your unit root happens when your beta becomes is equal to 1, and there is a persistent impact, and your time series is non-stationary. And the same thing, if you derive the equation with the previous lag, When you come to this equation, you can put that logic and try to see how unit root impacts the stationarity of the data. And how, now in the second part of the video, this is the second part of the video, and we'll see how this is used to derive the formula of ADF, okay, the Augmented Dickey Fuller test. Now we take the same equation, and this time we put alpha value is equal to 0 and mean is equal to 0. So this value here is now 0. So we'll be left with this equation, right? You have DT minus 1, beta minus 1, which is nothing but gamma, and the white noise, which is there. Okay. Now we add level and trend to this, because the scientists, when they were working and when they are working on the ADF test, the inventors of this model, they said that if we add the level and trend to this, there would be a better representation. So this equation which you had, and now I am calling delta DT as nothing but DT minus DT minus 1. So this is delta DT is equal to DT minus 1 plus the white noise, on which we'll now add the level and the trend. So this part was already there, and we have added the level and the trend on this part. And phi is the new coefficient. Okay. Now, if you generalize the equation over the lag, because they thought that for better fitting, more to adding level and the trend, they can add the lag of DT for a better model fitment. So we still had DT as the forecasted variable, but after even fitting level and trend from the ADF model, we need to add the lag of DT. Okay, so we add the lag of delta DT to the equation, and we derive the equation. Now I'll just derive it for you. So what we are trying to say is we have delta DT given in the equation, which is nothing but we first add the level and the trend, which is alpha plus phi t. So this is alpha plus phi t, just because we want to add the level and trend to this. Now we'll add this value, which is DT minus 1, the gamma of DT minus 1, right? And then we add the lag of delta T, because that for a better treatment. So we can generalize it. T minus 1 plus this new error I'm calling as E. So as you can see, this is the same thing. First we add the level and the trend, and then we generalize by adding the lag of DT minus 1. See, this is the sum of the lag. This is the sum of the lag of DT minus 1. And this one will give you the mathematical formula of the Augmented Dickey Fuller test. So first we generalize the equation. We add level and trend with it. So this part is adding the level and trend to it. And after that, for better fitment of the model, the ADF model states that we add the lag of delta T. So because that independent variable lags to itself. So there is a dependency of this variable delta T is dependent on its own lag, on its own past lags. So that's what this part of the equation does. And plus E is the new error term which would be coming. Previously we were showing error by only epsilon. Now, as you know, the null hypothesis here, always H0 in ADF test is not null, right? So if you say that my H0, my null hypothesis is true, so we accept H0, which means when it is non-stationary, and we know that the p-value is greater than 0.05. How do you get the p-value? In Python API, if you just put the KPSS or ADF test, you get the p-value. In this video, I'm just talking about ADF, and KPSS test is just the opposite of it. The null hypothesis is that a time series is stationary. Okay, and similarly, obviously, in ADF again, if I come back, we reject H0, and which means we accept H1. If you are rejecting the null hypothesis, you are accepting the alternative hypothesis. And if p, in this case, in that case, p will be less than 0.05, and you can conclude that your time series was stationary. So I think this video was helpful in understanding the mathematical intuitions behind unit root, and then how we use the unit root and how we use the lag of the independent variables of delta t minus 1 to derive the mathematical formula of ADF test for testing stationarity. Thank you so much. Comment up if you have anything to ask me, or any any areas in which you want me to make videos on. Please like, share and subscribe, and do check out the descriptions below for interesting updates and offers. Thank you so much, and I'll catch up with you in the next video.